some of them, and of course we'll open up the house to any kind of questions that you have. In all three presentations, I think the title of Dibyesh's paper echoes, that is the disconnect of democracy and nationalism. And this is something I think by the mid-20th century had become very evident when the shine of the anti-imperialist struggles had worn off, that nationalism and democracy don't in fact go together, but that nationalism is very much in a form, in a state of disconnect with democracy. And I actually found PK's identifying of the transcendental as central for the nation very useful here, because if you have to have a transcendental, which in these two presentations were technology and religion, but it could be the master race, it could be... So I guess the question that we could think about is the idea of a transcendental key for nationalism? Is it central for nationalism? And if so, can there be a democratic nationalism ever? Which would then, of course, raise questions about currently militant nationalisms which are countering larger, more powerful nation states, whether it's Kashmir or Palestine, or different kinds of nationalisms all over the world, including in the northeast parts of this subcontinent. Then the question arises, what happens to those nationalisms? Do they freeze back eventually into some form of transcendentalism when they achieve their goal? So there is that kind of question. The second kind of question, which both our visiting speakers, of course, brought up, is the question of the other, and othering of the, and how nationalism others. Now, of course, all identities other. There is no identity which can be produced except in relation to and in opposition to another identity. But whether that relationship needs to be antagonistic is the question. Is one identity always at the expense of another? So the othering that nationalism does appears to be, it produces a kind of closure of one identity over others, and I guess that's the disconnect with democracy, which of necessity has to be open. Democracy can only be a horizon, and it, as you approach it, new forms of democratic aspirations open up. So that openness is continuously in conflict with the particular kind of closure produced by nationalist othering. The question of fascism came up. As we know, this term is being somewhat loosely used in the Indian context. Nevertheless, there are many, many elements of fascism that we can see here. And I think one of the ideas that many of us are now thinking about is that if fascism and Nazism are actually specific terms for specific European phenomena, there are still, I mean, Italy, Germany, but there are also very clear markers which mark them out as the same phenomenon, then is Sangvad the phenomenon in India, Sanghism? Sangvad is of course a term used by our students. I found it extremely useful. And theoretically, I think if one could think of what elements of fascism does Sangvad encapsulate, what are the ways in which Sangvad is similar to or different from Nazism, fascism, but all part of a larger family of concepts. I think between, particularly with Ipshita's presentation, I was struck by the way in which elections are seen to exhaust democracy. As long as there are regular elections, a situation, society is assumed to be democratic, but in a sense it seems to exhaust all other questions of people's participation. So once a government is elected, then it is a kind of completely anti-democratic way in which policies are carried through, particularly, for example, the smart cities, which is a very brutal project, actually. It's a particularly brutal form of urbanization. India has seen some very brutal forms of urbanization, but the smart cities project might be one of the most brutal. So its shiny name actually hides a very, very vicious kind of violence. Yes, I think these are some of the different themes, and of course, finally, PK talked about the nation relating to different kinds of others in different ways, and that's also something I think that could help us think about some questions that might arise from all these three very rich presentations. So we're open for discussion.
So I had a few quick points for both speakers and possibly with a way of opening it up. Starting from the fascist question,